Hello there, and welcome to This Is Your Life. Now, over the past 6 months, we've traveled thousands of miles, and I've had dozens of different disguises. But tonight, it's not me who's going to be disguised, but our studio. And it's not just me who's going to hide, but lots of other people besides. In fact, our studios are disguised as a film studio, because the person who's due to arrive here any second now is due to meet someone at a film studio. And I'm only hoping that when she gets here and meets our receptionist, who's not really a receptionist, she'll understand that she's got to come along this corridor, because the man she's got to meet, our receptionist will explain, is at the other side of the building. And to get there, she will discover that when she gets this far, or just about, that she has, in fact, got to pass through a dark and empty studio. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. We may not have many seconds to spare. You can gather the setup now. I just want to explain that the people we've got to hide are you. With your cooperation. And the studio we've got to darken is this one. So may we have as many lights off as possible, all lights, in fact, just bar one, because I just don't know at what second our guest of honor will come tonight. But when she does arrive, she'll come through the doors you saw me come through, and I want you to keep as quiet as you possibly can. I'll be sitting somewhere here and hoping for the best that when she comes through, the rest goes off. All right, as quiet as you can. Let's have the rest of the lights out. Okay, lights out. Now, as quiet as mice.
Just. Just go straight through. He's waiting for you.
Oh, good.
Thank you, Marion. McLaughlin, Laurie, tonight, This Is Your Life.
I never
seat for you, seat for you. Here you are, you're here.
I really didn't realize this. Gosh.
Gosh, I heard you stumbling around the back there. I thought you were going to break an ankle before you got here. Lulu, it's great to see you. And this
Thank
is
you.
Your life, an exciting success story of a young Scottish girl who sang her way from the humble beginnings of Glasgow's East End to world fame as a television, film, stage, and cabaret artist. Now, Marion, when you first saw her, she was a schoolgirl singing in Glasgow at a beat club with that formidable name I just mentioned. How did she become Lulu?
Well, I really wanted a name that would be fun but memorable. And my brother, Tony Gordon, and I spent hours trying to think of something interesting. And all of a sudden, just to give myself a clue, I said, well, no doubt about one thing. She's a real Lulu of a kid. That was it. Lulu and the Lovers. We both agreed.
Ever since. And only 3 years ago, you changed the name again when you married world-famous BG pop star Morris Gibb. Why do you think he left the studio earlier? Now, you are with your brothers, Morris, the first time you and Lulu met. Tell us what she said, will you?
Well, we were in the canteen of Top of the Pops, which was our first English TV show, and she came up and introduced herself to us. And she went away after that and told a friend that we're the most big-headed bunch of boys she'd ever met in her life.
Well, now, how did you get over an insult like that?
Well, her friend told her that one of the Bee Gees fancied her. And she said, which one? And she said, the little one. That's me. And she went, oh, that's great. And then we went on a date, and we were in a club, and I was wearing this ring, which she fancied very much, and said, oh, I love that ring. And I said, yeah, well, you can have it if you want it. And I gave it to her, and she kissed me on the cheek, and pow, I was in love.
And she followed up the kiss on the cheek with a telegram, didn't she?
Yeah, the first of many. We were doing our first American tour, and we arrived in the States, and I got into the hotel. There was a telegram lying on the side, and I opened it up, and it read, I miss you, boo-hoo, Lou.
And when that young love came to marriage, Lulu not only got a BG husband, but two BG brothers-in-law. They were both at the wedding, and they're here tonight. Come in, Morris's brothers, Robin and Barry Gibb. Seats around there, boys. Right up there, there's seats of honor. And obviously by then, Lulu had changed her opinions about the Bee Gees. In fact, she and Morris, I gather, gave you both starring roles at the wedding, didn't they, Barry?
With the wedding?
Yes.
Well, at the wedding. At the wedding, Robin was the best man. He was the best man. Yeah. Well,
yeah,
and, well, I don't know what happened, but I went with them on the honeymoon.
And Lulu's...
Well, it's up to the imagination.
Lulu's one of the group's biggest fans now, right?
Well, of course.
There was a particular time in Jakarta. We were doing a performance there. The group, BGs, were doing a performance in Jakarta. And we were in 2 inches of water. There'd been a monsoon. There was 2 inches of water on the stage. And well, we were performing, but Morris would not pick up his bass guitar because if he did, he'd get 7,000 volts of electricity in him. So Lulu came round to the front of the stage and started to do a dance to get a gag Morris on to perform because he would not, no way, pick up this guitar on the stage. It was quite incredible, really.
And he did as a result of this, yeah?
Yes, he did.
And as still here alive, yeah? Lulu, you were only 15 when you rocketed to fame with a hit called Shout. And since then, your life as a singing star has taken you a long way from your native home in Scotland. You were born November the 3rd, 1948, in the Lennox Castle Maternity Home in Lennoxdown, Stirlingshire, and brought up here in Garfield Street, Denniston, the tufted east end of Glasgow, where you lived on the top floor of this tall tenement block. For 10 years of your childhood, that street was your playground. And after rough and tumble games with your friends, you entertained by singing on your own stage, the cold stone steps that led to number 29 on the top of that block. Now, your parents, who worked hard to bring you up there, no longer live in that street. They're still in Glasgow, but not tonight because they're here. Mom and Dad. And with them, your grandfather, Mr. William MacDonald. And your younger brother, now record producer and songwriter, Billy. Now, this is Laurie. We've heard how she got the name Lulu, but how did your little girl get such a long name in the first place?
Well, we had to please both the grandparents. You see, if a girl is born, you call them after the mum's mum, and if it's a boy, after the father's. So we just called her Marie, after my husband's mum. So to please my own mum and dad, we had to put McDonald, McLaughlin, Laurie.
And Miss Laurie, when she was a youngster, you added another name, didn't you?
Yes, Mrs. McLean.
Why was that?
Because she was always cleaning.
And one of Mrs. McLean's duties was to look after you, wasn't it, Billy?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. At that time, when we were much younger in Glasgow, it was a sort of regular thing for on a Saturday evening to have a party at our home, you know. It was like the Saturday night gig. You went to the Laurie's place. And the highlight of this evening always used to be when Lou would get up and sing a few songs. There was one occasion, though, because I was always the shy one in the family, and there was one occasion where I used
now.
To feel... Yeah. But I used to feel so down because... She was always singing, and I really wanted to sing, but I was terrible, really bad. So she taught me one song in particular, and that was We Were a Couple of Swells.
Oh, yeah.
Do you remember that?
Yes, I do.
How'd you fancy doing it?
No!
Oh, how dare you. How did it go? Come on, be serious. I know.
The only thing is, he's too good these days. He wasn't so good then, but now he's much better. And he was a lot smaller. He used to be about that height.
Well, I'll do it from here.
Right, yeah. Right. One, two, three, four.
We're a couple of swells. We live in the best hotels. In June, July, and August, we're away from the city smells.
Yeah. Thank you, the singing Laurie's. Well, Grandad, Mr. MacDonald, that's not the first time you've seen that brother and sister act, is it?
Oh, no, I saw a few times. And a lot of times after that with my real self.
You tell him, Dad. You tell him.
Yes, and you've got more. You tell me where that came from, right? We know that because Lulu's got another younger brother and sister, 8-year-old Gordon and 13-year-old Edwina. And now we're going to go to your parents' home in Glasgow to hear a bit of family entertainment they've been planning for you.
Hi, Lou. competition in the Pally when I won first prize for dancing to the record. Well, after I won the prize, they found out I was your young sister. Still, I still won the prize. Wow, it's great to have a sister like you.
Hi, Lou. Someday you're going to have a famous brother, too. Me!
Gordon, come in! And the winner! Well, Lulu, long before Gordon and Edwina were born, you were taking your first steps to a career in show business. As a child, you went with your parents to this holiday resort, Rothsay and the Kyles of Bute, and it was there at the age of three that you entertained holiday crowds at a Punch and Judy stall by singing to the music of an accordion. Now, that stall closed down 15 years ago, and the accordionist who accompanied you moved away. His name was Tony Marino.
Uncle Tony!
Tony Marino here. Hello, young lady. You might not remember me, but I remember you. You remember when you used to come down here and sing? I used to play for you?
Yes.
And then we had to ban you from the competition because you won every one of them. It's nice to say hello to you, but we've got to get on with the show, so bye-bye for now. On with the show!
It's 20 years since you saw him, but tonight he's here too, Tony Marino. Thank you, Tony.
Yes, that's it. Excuse the pun, but I'd like to say I'm as proud as Punch to be here.
And Lulu, it was the sound of another accordion that attracted you at the age of nine to the Tully Street Public Hall near your home in Glasgow. An accordion band was in mid-rehearsal, and you walked in and asked to sing.
She sang eight bars of two songs, and I gave her a job.
The man, yes, who gave nine-year-old Lulu a job as a singer with the Caledonian Accordion Band. You haven't seen him for 8 years. Producer and bandmaster, Billy McPhee, as you said. Now, Billy, that was 14 years ago, but you remember as if it was yesterday, don't you?
Oh, most certainly. Oh, she's not changed a bit. Most certainly.
What do you remember how she looked as she came in?
Well, a wee lass with a sticky throat.
A sticky throat.
Which I know is a ballerina now. I've been educated that much then. And she came and sung a part of Who's Sorry Now.
That's right.
And then about eight bars of Calvary.
Tony Francis, that's right.
Isn't that correct?
That's right.
Which I know to this day, according to your father, this is still your favourite song, Calvary.
That's funny, that's, but I haven't sung it for years.
And you gave her a job, she stayed with you for 4 years and toured all over Scotland. Now, what did you bill her as?
We billed her as the wee smasher, the Brighton.
And she was too. Thank you, Billy McPhee.
Thank you.
As a teenage schoolgirl, you found a new attraction, the sound of guitars and pop
goodness.
Music. In 1952, you joined a pop group called the Glen Eagles and sang with them at a club called the Lindella in Union Street, Glasgow. In fact, that's where you first saw Marion, yes? The Lindella.
Yes, that's right. My husband and brother, Tony, had opened a club called The Phonograph in Glasgow. And one weekend when we were all there together, we popped into the Lindella and saw the Glen Eagles with their tiny little songstress. And the thing that struck me about her so much was this rather pale, chubby little girl who had a really terrible cold, and she had her hair all in rollers under a strange little woolen snood, and she was wearing three cardigans, but she was so much in control of the whole thing, and the vitality was so remarkable that there was no doubt in my mind that.
Well, you were certainly right. So Mary Laurie and the Glen Eagles became Lulu and the Lovers. And the sound you and your group made soon reached the ears of two people who, in fact, are in our audience tonight. Scottish Daily Express show business editor Gordon Reid and record producer Peter Sullivan. On Gordon's invitation, Peter invited you to, at the Lindell, and immediately offered you a recording session. And in February 1964, just a matter of weeks after leaving school, you were in the Decca recording studios in London making your first record. Or so we thought, until late last night when, thanks to Morris, we discovered this. A record that you made in a shop just off Sackey Hall Street, Glasgow, when you were just 9 years old. And early this morning, and by early I mean 1 o'clock this morning, we found the family friend who took you there, and he's just flown in to tell us about it, Alex Crichton. this came about, this record?
Well, in those days I was a merchant seaman. Every time I was home and leave, I used to date Marie here, take her the pictures and buy her sweets and so forth.
I was only worried for that.
So one Saturday we were up the town and I decided that she'd be a singer, that I'd make a record of her.
I know you haven't heard this for 14 years, and if I can work this, you're going to hear it now, at least a bit of it.
Oh, must be a bit scratched.
When you walk in the garden, the Garden of Eden, with a beautiful woman, and you know how she cares, and a voice in the Garden of Eden, tells you she is forbidden.
I think it's great. Thank you, Alex Crichton. Thank you. Let's now go right back to that first record the world heard about, Shout. When it was released in April 1964, it shot straight into the pop charts and launched you on the road to success. You and your group, The Lovers, toured all over Britain and Europe until 1966, when the group disbanded and went their separate ways. But we've managed to trace them, and tonight, for the first time in 6 years, they've got together again, and here they are, The Lovers, Alex Bell, Henry Wright, Tommy Tierney, and Dave Wendell. You and the boys toured all over Europe with Lulu, and I believe she even learnt a new language, is that right?
Yes, English.
English? Tell us about that.
Well, she got a drop of a hat, she could switch from the Scots accent to this wonderful English accent. Yeah. I remember once we were in a theatre in the Midlands, and we were in the manager's office, and Lulu asked, she said, could I possibly use your telephone, please? I want to make a transfer call charge to Glasgow, in impeccable English. And he said, well, by all means, go ahead. So we carried on chatting to the manager. And Lulu's first question, when she phoned her mother, she always inquired after the children. And we were chatting away, and suddenly she was connected through, and she says, hello, Ma, how's the wains? The theatre manager turned around and went, a dog.
Thank you, Alex, Henry, Tommy, and Dave. Helped and encouraged by former jazz pianist Dick Katz, who's in our audience tonight too, you're at the top of the British pop scene by 1967. After 3 years of pop stardom, a television series, and a season in pantomime, you find yourself back at school, but discipline was strict.
And they banned Lou and I from sitting together.
That classroom was on the film set off to Sir With Love. That was one of your classmates, like yourself, making her film debut then, Adrian Poster. It didn't take you and Lulu very long to break your new school rules, did it?
No, well, you see, when we first started the film,
we
could pick who we wanted to sit with, you see, and I sat with her, this one here. And after about 3 or 4 days in the film, every time it came to us two, we'd be giggling, and they'd have to go back and do retakes, so they split us up. So in the end of the film, she was on one side of the classroom, I was on the other.
But when the giggling stopped and she knuckled down to some hard work, she left quite an impression on the rest of the cast, didn't she?
I think really the best bit of the whole film was when she sang the song at the end to Sydney, our star. And she really made us all cry and weep, and we... Oh, it was lovely.
Wonderful.
Thank you, Adrian Poster. Thank you. Well, that song that moved them to tear, of course, came at the end of the film when you're saying goodbye to the teacher you'd all given hell to all term. Film won rave notices for you, Adrienne, and of course for the leading star, Sidney Poitier, who cannot be here tonight. He's busy working on his latest film, but he's taken time off to greet you nevertheless. Sidney Poitier.
Hello, Lulu. I'm so sorry that I'm not able to be with you at this moment, the most remarkable moment in your life. Unfortunately, I'm working, and my schedule is rather tight. I am incidentally working at the same studio where you and I had such a remarkable experience and such a successful one in the film To Sir With Love. I must say that many of my private predictions for you have come to fruition, and I'm pleased about that. Principally, that you have become successful and that you are wearing it so well, and that you are using it on behalf not only of yourself, but many of the people with whom you are involved. I think that you are a wonderful person, a great artist, huge success to you, and may you live forever. Bye.
Thank you, Sidney Poitier. Well, now, the success of that film and the record, which sold more than 3 million copies, took you to the USA for the first time of many trips that have established you as an international star. November 67, you were chosen to sing in the Royal Variety Performance. Mr. Lurie, can you tell us what happened the morning after that show?
Yes, on the way to work that morning, I happened to glance at a newspaper, and my daughter being presented to the Queen. I felt so very, very proud. Very
I bet proud. You were, and here's that same picture your father saw, Lulu, of you being presented to the Queen there, but many more proud moments were to follow. You were voted Britain's top girl singer, top television performer, best guest dressed girl, joint winner of the Eurovision Song Contest. For the past 4 years, you've regularly captured the hearts of millions of television viewers with your own shows, and during one of those shows, you capture the heart of one of the screen's most dashing heroes.
It was love at first sight, and I owe it all to a computer.
And the dashing heroes dash straight from the set of his latest film, Alice in Wonderland, to be here tonight. Dashing Dudley Moore. And skinny Dudley Moore, should say. And what's all this about a computer, Dudley?
Well, we were brought together by the computer dating process. I thought I was a perfect match for Lulu. We had a wonderful, enchanting, romantic soiree.
Which I laughed throughout. I couldn't get my lines out. I was hysterical.
No, Lulu showed me her vocal range. I did, of course, put it to her that we should live in eternal happiness, but she didn't accept, because I think she had other plans in life. Thank you.
Thank you, Dudley Moore. Well, your other plans, your other real-life plans centered on February the 18th, 1969, when you changed your name to Mary MacDonald McLaughlin Gibb. You and Morris planned a quiet wedding for your family and a few close friends, and this is how it turned out. On that happy day, there could have been no one happier than the bride's mother that 5 years before had seen her daughter leave home at the age of 15 to find fame in London. Now, it must have been quite a wrench for you, Mrs. Lurie, as I know it was when Lulu first left home.
It really was, Amy, and I was quite broken-hearted. And I tried to coax my daughter out of not going away to London to be a hairdresser. And she turned round and she said to me, "Mum, I think God's gifted me with a voice. I might not be the world's best singer." She said, "But if I can make people happy singing, this is what I want to do." So what could I do?
That's sweet.
I'm so wonderful. I say such wonderful things sometimes.
She did.
But I know that when you knew she was well looked after down here, you were
happy,
even though you were sad to lose her. And I know who looked after you, Lulu. You stayed at her home until the day you married. You call her Auntie Janie, Marion's mother, Mrs. Jane Gordon. Yes. Well, now, from what I gather, Mrs. Gordon, there was some dispute between you and Lulu about who looked after who, right?
Yes, she won't admit it, but she definitely looked after me.
Oh, no.
What happened when she arrived?
She arrived and she came into the kitchen to me, and I was making sandwiches. And she said, "Now, give me that knife and I'll make them, because I'm so used to it at home. Don't be worried," she said.
And what about stardom? How did that change her?
Not at all. She's still the sweetest thing. After all these years, nearly 8 years, and when my husband died, she certainly took me over and said, "Jenny, you're coming with me everywhere," and I've been all over the world with her, and I still do.
Thank you, Mrs. Gordon.
Wonderful.
Thank you, indeed.
You're not married now.
And I know what's more, Lulu, that your grandfather's just as proud of you, right, Mr. MacDonald?
Well, about 2 years ago, exactly 2 years ago this month, Marie's mother came to me and said that Marie had booked a passage to Canada for me. And the people I was going to see, I hadn't seen them for 47 years. And to me, she'll always be a little smasher.
Mary Laurie, the little smasher, the wee smasher they'd love to have back in Glasgow, but are proud and happy for your success away from home. The wee smasher who sang in front of her first real audience with that accordion band of Billy's, the Caledonians, still going strong. And here again tonight to bridge the years between the little girl and the big star, Lulu Mary MacDonald McLaughlin Gibb. This is your life.
Oh, thank you.